I'm sort of a scaredy cat, so I'm not like straight up horror fan because I end up with nightmares. Let's see, I got a script and I was like, oh, I'm not really, I'm like quirky. I didn't really see myself as a horror film actress per se. But then when I read the role, there's a lot of me in that role, and I think that I actually had something personal to bring to it.
Quiet please, and action.
I liked working with Joe a lot. He was very sensitive, he was very present, he was very in tune, he liked to talk about the scene, he wasn't just barreling through. I've worked with several different directors, there's different approaches, sometimes very technical. I think he's actor sensitive, and I think he had a lot to manage because it's like the franchise and the studio and the writer and the actors, and he's a guy who seemed to be willing to like take all of that on, and he worked with me on things that I felt maybe not so comfortable with, and helped make me feel more comfortable and more invested in the part. So I really liked working with him. I didn't know anything about that place. I got there, checked into the hotel. I was, you know, whatever, a young girl in a different state. Went to bed, woke up, opened the curtains, and like the most massive storm had hit, and there was more snow than I had ever seen in my entire life. Meanwhile, the movie is like set in the fall, and I'm like, oh genius, there's like this much snow outside. I've never even seen that much snow in my life. So next thing you know, there the entire production is scrambling at like hosing down surfaces to make it look like it's the fall. I mean, I hate to be the actress who's like, oh my God, it was so cold, but it was.
Tonight's the night we bring some life back into this town.
Shit, Beth, why do we have to be the ones to organize this friggin' fair? I mean, it's only Halloween.
Keith Bogart was a lot of fun. I loved having him as my cinema boyfriend. Keith Bogart and I were the luckiest ones on the shoot. I don't know if people are aware of this, but we actually only worked for like a tenth of the overall shooting time, but they had to have us there the entire time. So in between, he and I were like sightseeing the entirety of Salt Lake City. We were like driving to Sundance to find the best restaurant. Like we were just bonding and hanging out and having a great time. It was like the dream job.
Beth, who's that guy who lives across the hall from you?
Why, are you interested?
Yeah, right. He's always staring out his window. Last night I caught him watching me.
That must be Tommy. On a weirdness scale of 1 to 10, he rates about a 13.
I think I'd met Paul at one of the auditions, like I think at Miramax I'd seen him there, and we became quite good friends and had a lot of meals together and whatnot during the shoot. And during the filming of Halloween 6, he was called out to LA to go have a callback for Clueless. And I think I may have even run lines with him for Clueless. I was like, go get him, Tiger, get the part. So, you know, you never know when you're in that situation, like if the next year somebody's quitting to become a librarian or if they're like launching into stardom. Obviously, Paul Rudd's career was launching into stardom, and you know, if anybody deserves it, he deserves it. He's a great guy. He's a sensitive actor. He really cares. Like he treated a Halloween 6 script like it was Shakespeare. Marianne Hagen and I we were like fast friends and very connected and like hung out offset and during and supported each other, and she had things about the role that she was asking me and my like, oh, what about this or that, and I feel like we were like soul sisters, or you know, she felt like a long lost cousin, which was really cool. Like we had that connection immediately, and Marianne was a pleasure to work with, and I was very enamored with her. I was looking up to her like a big sister. When I first went in for the movie, I actually read for the lead, I think twice. And then they took me outside and were like, can you come back in and do Beth? And I was like, okay, cool, blah, 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 you know, rehearsed the thing, went in. I get the call that I've gotten the part, but I need to be topless. Now, it's my understanding that you have to know these things before you audition so that you can decide if you want to audition. So at this point, I've got something that essentially I'm not fully ready to commit to because I didn't know about that. however the movie was Miramax, and I was getting like a line like straight down from Harvey Weinstein, like, we really want you in the movie. And I'm like, I really don't. I'm like, oh, David Lynch wants me to be topless? Sure. Halloween 6? I don't know. Like, I was a young actress and I didn't want to make a decision that was going to destroy my career. It's really not that I'm prude, but I want to present myself in a way that is with some integrity. Anyway, so I was like, oh, I read through the script again. Oh, am I going to do this? And I was like, okay, good. Here's how it's going to go. I will be topless, but you can only shoot me from one side. I think I was like the right side or the left side, and this is the length of time. And it was something like I agreed to 20 seconds. And the director called me up and was like, really, Mariah? And I was like, yeah, I think that's good. I think it's a classy length of time. It's not, I was just like, I don't want to be exploitative. Like, oh, this is the girl who's like topless and then she gets killed. And you know, I didn't even see myself as the kind of actress that would be booked for that part, just based on my body type. You know, I wasn't like a, that kind of an actress. But I don't have a, you know, I don't have a negative opinion of that. And ultimately, I'm really happy I did it. However, there is the occasional, my 16-year-old daughter has friends over from high school who are like, we just saw Halloween 6. And I'm like, oh, yeah, awesome. Of course, going to see the movie and sitting next to my mother was kind of fun. She was like, oh, Mariah, your boobs are so cute. Horrible, like not something you want to hear.
Carol, what the hell is going on?
Beth, look out, there's someone in the room. He's right behind you.
As far as the death scene, I think that from the moment that I was cast until the moment I shot that, I was terrified about it. Not so much the element of like, like I'm gonna be killed in this movie, but it's like, how do you act that? How do you practice that? Like, I come from a school of acting where it's like, yeah, I wanna physically experience those things fully and bring something that feels like real and organic to it. And this is just something that you've not experienced. You can't, you know, you can imagine what that's like. But I didn't want it to be like utterly ridiculous, but you want it to be realistic. And how do you bring the physicality and the emotionality to that without having ever experienced it? Ironically, the suspense and terror that I carried with me about acting it, when I got there to shoot it, I was just bringing that. Like whatever fear that I had about the scene, just to bring that to my face. And it's scary to play that out and have somebody come up behind you with a knife. There seemed to be a few different concepts floating around about what the movie was. And there was this thing where I think some of us were trying to make like a classic horror film, and then there was this other camp that was trying to make something else. By the time I was called for a cast and crew screening, I had heard there'd been reshoots. I think Keith or something told me, oh, do you hear what's happening with the movie? They want to go back and fix the ending, change the thing. So when we went to a screening, I watched the movie and was like, where is the script for the movie that I acted in? Like, I didn't understand what they had done to it. But, you know, I like it. I'm a classic girl. I like it clean and classic. You don't have to go too out there for me. So I think the original script would be my preference. I have absolutely no regrets about it, about the nudity, about appearing in the film. I've received a lot of fan mail over the years. My daughter thinks it's hilarious. She's like, Mom, you still get fan mail from Halloween 6? I'm like, these people are diehards. Like, if they're down, they're down. I'm an interior designer now, and I was hired by Edgar Wright to decorate his house. And we're in his house talking about his screening room or something. And oftentimes I don't want to mention to people that I was an actress, just mainly because I don't want to throw, like, we're there to decorate the house. This isn't about what Mariah used to do before she was an interior designer. But somehow I had this internal thing of like, mention it, don't mention it, mention it, don't mention it. And I just thought, like, with the type of movies he makes and whatnot, I might just mention it. And it was, I don't like to do that. So I was like, oh yeah, blah, blah, blah. I was in Halloween 6. Edgar's like, you, oh, he's so excited. Like, he loves that. He loves the Halloween movies. He thinks it's hilarious. Like, the idea that he was hiring an actress from Halloween 6 to design his house, like, couldn't have been better. He still mentions it. He's always like, I'm gonna screen the movie at my house. You have to come over. Let's invite people. Like, it's so funny. So you never know who's gonna be, like, totally enchanted by it. So on that note, according to Edgar Wright, I'm a movie star. Interestingly enough, a movie that I almost passed on is probably my claim to fame. I mean, I've done better, much more complex characters and more difficult acting jobs, but Halloween 6 is my claim to fame. All over the world, there's like Halloween 6 fans in other countries. So I, you know, the movie that I almost passed on turned out to be the thing that I'm the most famous for. I'm not seeking fame and fortune, so it doesn't matter either way, but I do, I enjoy it. I think it's funny. I think it's cool. It's not something I'm embarrassed about, like I said. You know, with Edgar, I was like, do I tell him? And then, you know, he was just totally enchanted. So I think it's a fun little cocktail party conversation.
It was just an audition, and like any other audition, I didn't realize they were recasting until after the first call. Ross just sat and talked to me for a while. He told me, you know, they were casting the girl who was in 4 and 5 Grown Up. He sent me home with the script, told me to come back the next day. I rented 4 and 5 so I could watch it, and came back, talked to him some more, and then he sent everybody home in the middle of my interview and said, I'm casting you. So that was probably the easiest role I ever got. I had to go buy some brown contacts before I went to Utah, and they talked about a wig maybe, which I really wish they would have done. I think they liked my short hair for that because it looked cultish, but I think I would have looked more, you know, I look nothing like Danielle. I mean, we always laugh about it because it's like, I guess we both have dark hair and sort of almondy eyes.
No, please, my baby, please give him to me. Damn you!
I had a really great experience with Joe. You know, my experiences on that set were super isolated. I wasn't working with other actors. I was running. He was always very precise with his direction, with what he wanted from me. He was always very clear. Oh, and Joe, this was funny because he was like, you don't look like you're running with a baby. So he put a 20-pound sandbag in the thing, and it looks really great on camera, but I thought, well, I don't think I would have a 20-pound baby. I just think that might be a little big, I don't know. It was freezing there. I mean, it was freezing. I had snow up to my knees with a rain machine on me and a hospital gown with like six or seven pairs of long johns under that, but it was still freezing. And then I am from New York, so I'm not, you know, the LA girl, like, I can't take the cold. It was freezing. It was a different kind of cold, so. When I went into hypothermia shooting the scene that was the escape from the hospital, it happened very, very quickly. I'm in the little hospital gown and I'm wearing 10 layers of cold clothes, which only helps until they're all soaking wet and ice cold and freezing over. And, you know, I mean, I guess what happened was, I remember being really, really cold, and then next thing I remember I was in my trailer, like warming up, and the AD said to me, I looked at him and said, feel anything from my waist down, and he just went, she's coming off set. He's like, I'm responsible for your safety, so. I gotta say, it's like, those are the things, though, that you talk about. Those are the experiences that you go, my job is so cool. You know, I mean, like, yeah, I was freezing and I went to hypothermia, but I went into hypothermia in Utah with this giant Hollywood rain machine on me with snow up to my waist and Michael Myers chasing me, you know, it's just like, my job is cool. I love the location out on that farm with the truck, and it was really big, and it felt, you know, being there, you're like, this is where this could happen, you know, as opposed to a sound stage. I really like that. I like that you don't, it's like, you don't see it coming. It's almost like you don't know quite what's happening. And I like that when I like the last sort of like when he walks by his foot, just sort of, you can't have the baby, Michael. It's like, it works so well in that moment. And my death scene in the producer's cut is not in the farm, it's in the hospital. And I always forget about that because, and I think I block it out because I didn't, that was something that tested really poorly, was that, you know, the sort of double death of Jamie. I believe it tested poorly in being shot. You know, there's not a lot of gunshot victims in Halloween films. So I think I forget all the time that the man in black snipers me out with a gun. That should have gone regardless of the reshoots. But the death scene in the barn would have been nice, with just the stabbing that she doesn't see coming. People in general did not seem very happy about the reshoots. When we were shooting the original, there was a unified vision that was communicated to me, at least, that this was going to be more old school with the sort of suspense. At least from my perspective, that was the intention of the film as it was shot. And then when we went into the reshoots, it just totally became disjointed. Nobody seemed very happy about it. I knew it was going to be hard for them to match me because my hair was, I think, blonde at the time we did the reshoots, and I had lost about 7 or 8 pounds since we shot the movie, and so it was like, well, this is going to be interesting. It just didn't feel like what Halloween's supposed to feel like to me, you know. So in the final cut with the farm tiller, and I really disliked that death scene. I don't think it was scary like that. I'm of the opinion that when there's too much blood and gore, it takes away from the mental anxiety of what I like so much about the genre stuff, you know. And it was flat and dark, and I don't think there's any sympathy for Jamie at that point. I think that you really need to, after all of the films, go, oh God, we just lost that character. I'm a fan of Dan Ferens. I think he's a terrific human being, and he's a great writer, and he has a real passion for what he's doing. I think he personally would have loved to have, I think he would have loved to done more with Jamie and honor her character differently. I don't know a lot of the details before I was involved, but the conversations I've had with him lead me to believe like he had more for her in the original script, which I guess as a fan of the series would have been nice, but as an actress, I'm like, well, then Danielle might have done it, and then I wouldn't have gotten to do this really cool film and meet all these really great people. So, and Jamie's a great character, you know. I mean, I think she's iconic, and I think that what Danielle created is amazing with her at such a young age, you know. But I didn't really realize what I was stepping into before I got on set, because in the script, it's just such a small part. I look back at all the things I've done, and it's like that in Star Trek. You can't, you know, even if I never do anything again, how cool is that?